So, what are the impacts of that? Well, one of the impacts is meat. All those animals have bacteria in their gut, okay? You give them antibiotics, you're helping to create resistant bacteria in the gut of that cow or that pig or that chicken. Well, eventually that animal goes to slaughter. And, you know, do you think that the slaughterhouse is a pristine facility where there's no manure, there's no guts, there's no entrails? Of course not. Everything that was in that animal, including the guts and the bacteria and the manure, is all over the slaughterhouse floor. So we know that people working in those slaughterhouses are getting colonized, infected with resistant bacteria in greater numbers than you or I. We know that the meat coming out of those slaughterhouses, raw meat, mind you, it's not like cooked at the slaughterhouse, right? Raw meat carries antibiotic-resistant bacteria on it. So this is the last good numbers I could find from 2014, and this is a federal program that looks at meat samples and looks to see what percentage of the meat samples it collects are resistant to multiple antibiotics. So numbers are high in a lot of cases, right? You can see that. So I tried to highlight the ones in red. So here you have almost 40% of the beef that had salmonella on it. Those salmonella were resistant to three or more drugs. 36% of the turkey that had salmonella on it, that salmonella was resistant to three or more drugs, and so on and so on and so on. So, you know, for a lot of these meats, there was a pretty good chance if you went to the grocery store that you'd be getting a drug-resistant bacteria on that raw meat. Well, the food safety folks say, oh, yeah, this has been a problem for a long time. All you got to do is cook the meat well, because, you know, then it's not an issue, right? Wrong. Yes, it's good to have cooked meat for these reasons. You're not going to ingest cooked meat and get antibiotic-resistant bacteria in your gut, but what else are you going to do? Well, you're going to have the meat on the countertop, and then you're going to have the knife, and then your kid's going to come up and slap their hand on the countertop. So there are other ways to spread resistant bacteria from raw meat to people in your household, to you, if you're the one doing the food preparation. And what about upstream? What about all that manure on the farm or at the slaughterhouse? Basically, resistant bacteria is everywhere that animal has created manure, everywhere that manure is gone. So it's an environmental problem. It's not just a meat problem. It's not just a food safety problem. So what we've done basically, whether we're talking about antibiotic use in people or use of the same drugs in animals, is that we've created these environmental reservoirs, that's what they call them, reservoirs of resistance. So in those reservoirs are residues of drugs, yes, but also resistant bacteria and the genes that make those bacteria resistant. The genes that make those bacteria resistant. And those reservoirs include our food supply. They include livestock farms. They include wastewater treatment plants. They include the streams downstream of a manure lagoon, downstream of a wastewater treatment plant, and the communities downwind, because I didn't know this until I started researching it, but resistant bacteria collect on dust particles. So when the wind blows off of one of these hog farms and you're 1 mile, 2 miles downwind, you're exposed to resistant bacteria. So, there have been people, fortunately, who've been kind of sounding the alarm about this problem. I did tell you it wasn't a simple problem. It's not a straightforward problem. It's really complex. But even in 1976, nope, 1998, Stuart Levy was a physician at Tufts University, microbiologist, still is. He's kind of retired now, but for decades, he was the most prominent person saying, this is a big problem. You should be paying more attention to this. And what I thought he said in this article from Scientific American, you know, this is pretty readable, so even if you're not a scientist, I really recommend it. You know, now it's going on 20 years old. And it said, you know, the whole world is like one big organism, and we're all little bits and pieces in that organism, especially the bacteria. And the genes are passed around throughout that entire world. So it's not just the bacteria that can hop in the plane or hop in the dirty water or hop in the meat, it's the genes. And this is where it gets a little more complex yet, because the genes don't always just stay within the bacteria, they get swapped between the bacteria. You're swapping your genes with me, I'm swapping my genes with my dog or my cat. You know, the farm animals swapping their genes with the hospital. There's free flow of these things all over the place. Really tough to track, but the scientists who've really been focused on this can show you how this resistance travels from one reservoir to the next and back again. So we've got instances where drug-resistant MRSA traveled from hospitals to hog farms in the Netherlands and then back to the hospital inside of a farmer from that farm. So in fact, if you go to a hospital now in the Netherlands, because this has been such a big problem there, and they find out that you live in a farm or work in a farm, they'll automatically put you in isolation for MRSA until they can show otherwise that you're not carrying it. Like, there's that much back and forth. So let's get down to basics. This is a fun little cartoon. I don't remember what these things are called, but my kids played with them. But this signifies you or me, and the red things are bacteria. And again, we've got trillions and trillions of bacteria in our guts, right? All of us do. And inevitably, some of them, maybe you've been on antibiotics for a recurrent sinus infection. Well, you stay on antibiotics long enough, you're going to get some bacteria resistant to those drugs. And that's the one with the little lightning bolt. That's the resistant bacteria. How did it get resistant? Well, actually, a variety of ways. Maybe it's something you got from your environment. Okay, maybe you ate it. But it could also have mutated. So the resistance could be something that just popped up through mutation. And how or why does that happen? Like, you or I don't mutate, right? True, but we live, you know, 80-year lives. A bacteria, you know, its life is like that. So the generational time, they're reproducing very quickly. There's a lot more opportunities for mutation in bacteria. Then you multiply all those opportunities by the fact that there's gazillions of bacteria, and it's not surprising that mutations pop up. So that's one way. You can get it from your environment. You can get the resistance from a mutation. They can get it from other bacteria. So what happens is, if you or I, the person in the picture, is exposed to antibiotics, maybe it's in our food supply, maybe it's because we're taking them, we're creating a pressure that selects for that resistant bacteria. What do I mean by that? What I mean is that we put antibiotics in our gut, and all the susceptible bacteria, the non-resistant bacteria, are going to die out. What's that leave? That leaves that little resistant bacteria. What's he going to do? He's going to do what bacteria do. He's going to multiply. So pretty soon, instead of having this really diverse gut flora of healthy bacteria and maybe a resistant one here or there, you've got a gut flora that's filled with resistant bacteria, or at least more filled. Guess what? Same thing happens in pigs. I mean, you've probably heard, right? that pigs physiologically are very close to people. We're both mammals, we're both big mammals. We even use parts from pigs in heart surgery, porcine valves, right? That's how much alike humans they are. And like us, they've got trillions of bacteria in their gut. Like us, they're getting antibiotics. Now, as I said, some of them are getting a lot more antibiotics than we would get, and they're getting them basically throughout their entire lives. And so this process happens much more quickly. Now, there's about 370 million Americans, but there's about 100 million more pigs. And every one of those pigs is like a little incubation container for a resistant bacteria to form. And of course, those bacteria don't just stay in the pig, do they? They get pooped out. So everywhere that hog manure goes, we've got not only resistant bacteria, but we've got antibiotics. 75% of the antibiotics that go in a pig's feed end up in their manure. If the manure goes somewhere, say it gets spilled into a stream nearby, say it turns into dust, those dust particles, that waterway, they're carrying resistant bacteria and antibiotic residues sometimes. So basically all the makings for a little antibiotic resistance factory. Well, what happens next? I didn't lead with this because I was hoping you'd see where I was going, but anybody know who this guy is? This is Darwin, right? What did Darwin say? He said populations will change if you put a stressor that selects for the fittest population. Well, here we got a population of bacteria. What's our stressor? Our stressor is antibiotics. So we're selecting for the most resistant antibiotic. So if we have antibiotics in our system, which we do, lots of them, and we've got resistant bacteria, resistance genes in our system, we do, we're driving resistance. And that's what's happening on all our pig farms. That's what's happening in our hospitals. That's what's happening in our community. I said 100 million pigs, but we actually have 9 billion chickens. That's just the annual, that's just the annual harvest rate. So that's a lot of little animal factories, which, if they're getting antibiotics routinely, are helping to breed and spread resistant bacteria. So, Netflix episode number 4 or something like that. We're going to talk about these factories. What's actually happening at a micro level in these factories? What do I mean by resistance genes? There's a couple things I want to explain. Resistance genes don't exist in isolation, right? So we have chromosomes, right? We have 26 chromosomes. Each of those chromosomes has a lot of genes. They're connected on pieces of DNA. That's what a chromosome is. So it's pieces of DNA all in a row. Same thing in a bacteria. They have pieces of DNA, and a lot of times, they don't just have that penicillin resistance gene there. They've got lots of genes. And a lot of those genes are connected, and they're all helping that bacteria create something that makes them resistant to different antibiotics. Okay? So say that piece of DNA is on a loop. You might have resistance to cephalosporins like fluoroquinolones like ciprofloxacin, but you also might have resistance to tetracycline, and it's on the same long piece of DNA. They're connected. Now, by the way, we don't only have resistance to antibiotics. We also have resistance to metals. We also have resistance to other ingredients in cleaning products. And part of our environment is to be exposed to all these other things. Why is that important? Well, it's important for this very crucial reason, cross resistance. I'm getting kind of in the weeds here with microbiology, but basically what it means is that you don't have to be exposed to penicillin to select for bacteria that are resistant to penicillin. You can be exposed to cephalosporin. And because the resistance to those two drugs is linked, because it's on the same piece of DNA, being exposed to one helps make sure that you're selecting for bacteria resistant to all the other things on that piece of DNA. Think of this from the bug standpoint. So you're just kind of living your life, you're a bacteria, you're not resistant at all. Any bacteria is gonna, any antibiotic's gonna harm you, okay? Well, suddenly, your pal, who's a superbug, you meet up with him for the first time in years, he transfers all his resistance genes to you. This happens all the time. Bacteria are very promiscuous with their genes, including their resistance genes. So suddenly, all these genes that made your buddy resistant, now they make you resistant too. So in a flash, just in an instant, as soon as me, you know, I used to not be resistant, now I'm resistant to 8, 10, 12 different drugs. And it's happened just like that. That's what's happening in all these reservoirs of antibiotic resistance. And it can happen very quickly. Now you factor in the fact that these resistant bacteria are multiplying so quickly, and you can understand how you can go from a single resistant bacteria to a billion in the span of 24 hours. And now we've been overusing these antibiotics for how long? You know, since 1950, basically. So that there's been a lot of time for this. It seems like it's, hey, all of a sudden we've got problems with resistance. No, this has been brewing a long time. So, different reservoirs. I mentioned wastewater treatment plants. This is like a little super factory for drug resistance to form and spread. The problem isn't that we shouldn't be treating our waste, okay? We should, of course. The problem is that what's going in there besides just our poop is the antibiotics we flush down the toilet and the residues of all the antibiotics that we have taken. So, you know, sick people are still going to be creating feces, right? There's no getting around that. But if we stop, the estimates are that about 50% of human antibiotics are overused, are unnecessary uses in hospitals and clinics, probably even more in clinics than in hospitals, but you know, as much as half overall. That's a lot. And a lot of them are ending up here. So if we address the overuse, then we address the problem.